Stock market valuations near all-time highs, the threat of inflation, and super low interest rate. What does that have to do with your retirement? I want you to stick around here as Jason Newcomer, Certified Financial Planner, Director of Financial Planning here at Barber Financial Group. He and I are going to dive in to every single rolling 20-year period since 1972. And we're going to measure inflation, and we're going to measure what bonds did, and we're going to measure what equities did, and we're going to look at what happened to portfolios as you start to try to take a 5% withdrawal stream and keep up with inflation. Enjoy this presentation. Hello, everybody. I'm Dean Barber, founder and CEO of Barber Financial Group, along with Jason Newcomer, certified financial planner, director of financial planning at Barber Financial Group. Jason, we got some exciting information to share with people today. You and your team did a lot of research here for one major purpose, and that was to run through all of the 20-year rolling periods going all the way back to 1972 and looking at two things, a 60-40 portfolio and a withdrawal rate starting at 5% and then increasing that withdrawal rate every year with whatever the inflation rate was for that year so that people can have a standard of living that remains constant.
Right.
Okay. And we're doing this because a couple of phenomenons that are happening today. Number one, we've got market valuations, not the market, the number on the market, but valuations in the market that are higher than we've seen since just before the dot-com bubble. And we have a lot of talk about potential inflation. And we've got ultra low interest rates at this time. So we've got some dynamics at play here that are different than what people have experienced over the last 20, 30, maybe even 40 years. And we need to talk about it because there's a lot of people that are entering into retirement right now. And I want to make sure that they understand what expectations should be set forth for them.
Yeah. And people get nervous, you know, right or wrong. Anytime you hear the headline, the market has made a new all-time high today. It sends up little alarm bells, and you think about that, that's normally, that's a good thing, right? Markets are at all-time highs. We like to see new all-time highs get made, and I think we've seen more than 50 just this calendar year new all-time highs be made.
Right, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, and when you look at the backdrop of economic activity that's happening right now, the market could maintain its elevated status for quite some period of time. In fact, markets can be overvalued for a longer period of time, especially when you have strong economic growth as a background.
Yeah, but tell that to someone who is getting ready to retire, to give up their paycheck, to start drawing down their investment assets, and now you've got some nerves that enter in.
Yeah. Let's start by looking at this chart that you put together now. It's very, very busy, so I'm going to draw our attention here to a couple of different things. So let's start off with this period from 1972 to 1991. And what I want to look at, first of all, is the average annual return on this particular 60-40 model from 1972 to 1991 is right here, 11.65%. So if we stopped right there and set a 60-40 portfolio starting in 1972, going through 1991, averaged 11.65%. So if I look at that and say, I can take 5% that first year, and then I can increase my income each year to keep up with inflation, you would think that that 11.65% would be ample to allow me to take the income I need and not even have to worry about running out of money.
On its face, it sounds like, yeah, no brainer. Like, I should be totally fine with that.
Right. Yeah. There's two other factors that people have to look at. Number one is the sequence of returns. In other words, what were the returns in the early years? And what were the returns in the later years? And then the other one is, what was the inflation rate during that period? So if we look at this, scroll over to the left a little bit, we had average inflation over that 20-year period of 6.29%. Now, we haven't seen that in our lifetimes. It's been, you know, 2-3% type inflation rates that people have been experiencing. But does that mean that we can't go back and see those higher inflationary periods? And then we had a scenario here where the first 5-year real return was a negative half a percent. So explain the real return.
Right. So everyone's familiar with something called nominal return. You might not be familiar with the term nominal return, but all we're talking about here is what's the rate of return that you earned on your portfolio. You look at your statement, you log into your account and see I've made 10%. That's your return in nominal terms. It's on paper, I made 10%. But real return is where you subtract out inflation. So if inflation is 6% and I made 10%, my real return, I'm only 4% better when I factor in inflation.
Right. Okay. So let's go through this. If we started with $50,000 a year, that being 5%, and we continued to take that withdrawal and we kept up with inflation over a 20-year period, we would have drawn $2.138 million. And what are we looking at here? We've got an ending balance of only $427,000.
So we kind of barely made it by the skin of our teeth, I guess, over that 20-year period.
We barely made it. And you look at the next 20-year period from 1973 to 1982, you had a 6.27% average inflation, an 11.49% average annual return. Those two, you would think at face value, should come out fairly even.
Mm-hmm.
But look what happened. By the end of 20 years, your account balance was down to just $68,000.
Yeah, and the number that I'd really draw attention to here is the first five-year real return.
So negative 3.82% was your real return for the first 5 years.
Yeah, yeah. And that's really what killed this scenario here. That's what after 20 years, you've run out of money in your portfolio.
Let's dive into those years a little bit deeper. So let's look at and examine what did the markets do during that period of time. So we've got the U.S. stock market, we've got the 10-year treasury, 1973. We had inflation of 8.71% that year. The stock market lost 18%. 10-year treasury made 3.29%. So your portfolio lost 9.6%. The following year, the market went down 27.8%. 10-year treasuries made 4%. That means you lost 15%, but look at inflation in 1974, 12.34%.
Just compounding the bad scenario there.
Right. So here's one thing that I think is fascinating. Starting in 1973 with our $50,000, in order to keep up with inflation, by 1981, we needed $106,000, almost $107,000, Jason, to buy the same thing the $50,000 bought just 8 years earlier.
Yeah, our cost of living, to maintain that same standard of living, we've more than doubled our withdrawal.
Right. So here's what happens. We got a market value of $689,000, and we need to take $107,000 out? Well, we're not at a 5% withdrawal anymore.
No.
Now, the reality is, you and I both know, if this scenario played out for somebody, they would not allow this to happen. They would stop spending. They would cut back on all kinds of things, and they would reduce their standard of living before they would take out $107,000 on a portfolio that's only worth $689,000, especially just 8 years into retirement.
Probably even have to consider going back to work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very, very possibly. So this is an important part, Jason, where we want to talk about how we actually look at this, because these types of scenarios can play out in the future. And so in our planning programs, we use something called Monte Carlo simulation. And so we're stress testing portfolios through these types of conditions to make sure that they can actually work. And we do actually a historical audit as well as a Monte Carlo simulation so that we can take a portfolio that somebody has today and we can say, let's run that portfolio back through this inflationary period of the 70s and let's see how it would have worked. And then we get some clarity. And then we can also go in and say, what would have worked back then?
Right.
Right. So that gives us the ability to say, okay, if this coming, then what we need to do is we need to make adjustments to portfolios in order to try to fight this off as best we can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's making adjustments to portfolios, the allocation, even the distribution strategy. How much are we going to be pulling out in a good market? Maybe it's a higher percentage that we're able to pull out. Because typically when we're talking about retirements, we're talking about spending the most money, maybe over your retirement in the first 5 years, 10 years of retirement.
It depends on how young you are when you retire. I mean, if you retire at 60, you might have a good 15 years of really solid spending. And if your health is good, that may continue for 20 years.
Sure.
So, let's go back here for just a minute, 'cause I want to point this out. I've said many, many times on my radio program, I've said many times on podcasts and videos that we've done, that you can't spend average annual returns. You can only spend actual returns.
Yep.
Okay. And so this is a perfect example where we have two scenarios here where we've got average annual returns above 11%, yet in both cases, we come pretty close to running out of money. Now, here's what I find is fascinating. If we take this 1 year forward, Jason, just 1 year, and we retired in 1974 instead of 1973, we still had those high inflationary periods here, but we didn't start off with the two horrible years in a row of the market. We just had one bad year in the market, and then that was followed up by two really good years in the market. And look at what Treasuries did here, 15.29% in 1976. So we wound up with a 22% return and a 24.9% return. Bottom line is, you still needed to keep up with inflation, but in this scenario, you wind up with almost $2 million at the end of the day, keeping the same standard of living as somebody that retired a year before you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And here we've talked about before that it's, you know, when we talk about sequence of return risk, just the risk of you retiring at the wrong time, things are out of your control. It's not necessarily just the sharp decline in the market followed by a recovery, you know, the typical run-of-the-mill bear market. That puts your retirement long-term in jeopardy. It's the prolonged period of, you know, the compounding storm of high inflation, poor returns at the beginning, poor real returns over a 5-year, 10-year period in retirement.
So, Jason, this is fascinating. And here's one of the things I think is really critical for us to point out to people that are watching this video. So what you've done here is a 60-40 portfolio, and you're assuming a systematic withdrawal. So we're selling each month a portion of the stocks and a portion of the bonds, and we're rebalancing at the end of each year, and we're keeping and maintaining that 60-40 average. If you took and invested $1 million and you didn't have any withdrawals, it doesn't matter what the sequence of return is. If it averages 11.7 or 11.4, you're going to wind up with the same amount regardless of whether you had the good returns at the beginning or the good returns at the end. One of the things that we like to do, especially if somebody's heading into retirement with valuations where they are today, is let's step back and say, all right, what are we going to need to live on out of the portfolio for the first 3 or 4 years? Maybe even the first 2 years for sure. Let's set that aside in something that can't lose money. And let's spend that. That way, if these things occur, we give the markets an opportunity to reset and to regain our composure. And if we have a good year, we can actually take those winnings and put that back over into the very safe account. That can prevent something like what we saw happening in 1973 to 1992 from happening.
That's right. In a scenario like that, where you're set aside maybe 2, 3, 4 years of cash reserves or something liquid that's not tied to the performance of the market, you're not having to go in and sell off those stocks that are down 30, 40, 50% in a bear market.
Exactly. All right. I want to fast forward, and we're going to look at 1980 to 1990 to 1999, totally different time frame, right? We still are going to start out with taking the 50,000, then we're going to increase it to keep up with inflation. But we didn't need to double our income until out here in 1995. So we went a full 15 years as opposed to 8 years before we needed to double our income. We actually wound up at the end of that 20-year period, Jason, keeping our standard of living exactly the same for that 20-year period, was $7.28 million. Now, that's a far cry from the person that retired in 1973.
Mm-hmm.
Yet we did the exact same strategy.
Yep.
Right? So here's what I think happens to a lot of people. Well, I call it recency bias. In 1999, we were right in the middle of the tech bubble. We had Alan Greenspan talking about irrational exuberance. You're too young. You weren't in the business at that point in time, but I remember it well. And in 1999, people were saying in our industry that, you know what, that 5% withdrawal rule that you did, or the 6% withdrawal rule, that's dead. You can withdraw 8% and it's going to be safe. All right. Now, the last time that we saw valuations as high as they are today was actually at the peak of the market in 1999, just before the dot-com bubble burst. Okay. So now what I want to do is I want to fast forward, and people are looking at what happened in the last 20 years right here. They're looking at it and saying, if I do a 60-40 portfolio, why couldn't I take 8%? I can take that and I'm still going to have a heck of a lot of money left over. And guess what? I'm going to have a better retirement life. So now somebody retires in January of 2000, and here you go. You get a negative 10, you get a negative 11, you get a negative 21 in the stock market. But look at what Treasuries did here, Jason. Treasuries in 2000 earned 17.25, 5.4, and 15.45 respectively. So before we get too deep into what's going on here, I have a question for you as a certified financial planner, understanding how bonds react in different interest rate environments. What do you think the mathematical possibility is that in the next market downturn, if that were to occur in the next couple of years, that Treasuries are going to be able to give that kind of a boost to a portfolio?
It'd be pretty tough. Interest rates are totally different than they were 20, 21 years ago. Back when we were in the year 2000, we had Treasuries significantly higher than where they're at today.
Yeah, I mean, back then you could even go buy a 5.5% or a 6% CD.
Right.
So your 10-year Treasuries were doing better. So what happened during the recession, the dot-com bubble? Interest rates fell. As interest rates fall, bond values rise. We can't have that phenomenon when we've got a 10-year Treasury yield hovering around 1.3%. Right. So we can't expect that to be the case. But again, we just took out 5%. We continued that. All we had to do is get to $75,959 of income, and we have the same standard of living that we had at $50,000 in 2000. So we didn't have to take out near as much money out of our portfolio. But look what happens. We're down to $647,000 at the end of 2019, taking a $75,000, almost $76,000 withdrawal. Again, we're well above that 5%.
Yeah, we're north of 10% there. And if you just run the quick back of the envelope math, this portfolio with that level of spending is probably not going to last much longer.
Yeah.
Right?
No, it might maybe 7-8 years.
Yeah.
So the thing that I think people really have to get is that when they're thinking about, okay, I'm going to retire, market valuations are high. We talked about it at the very beginning of the video. It's scary. What do you do? How do you position yourself? The only answer is a comprehensive financial plan using our guided retirement system.
Planning's got to be a part of it. You can't just set it and forget it, because I would make the obvious statement here of the scenario where we had $65,000 left in the balance of the account after 20 years. That plan has failed. That was a bad plan to begin with. Alternatively, you could look at one of these scenarios where you've left behind $7 million.
That was a bad plan too.
That was also probably a bad plan. Exactly right, because we weren't making adjustments and saying, hey, we've had better than expected market growth. Your balance in your account after, you know, the first few years of retirement is significantly better than what we thought it would have been.
Let's adjust your lifestyle.
Exactly.
Adjust your spending. Give money away. Do charitable things. Help out your kids. Do something college for your grandkids. If those things weren't already in the retirement plan, you can start to add those things in.
That's right. So planning has to be dynamic. It has to be constantly done, monitored. That's part of the financial planning process, is to monitor the plan, right? And make adjustments as time goes on.
And what you've modeled here is two things: U.S. total stock market and the 10-year Treasury. All right. So I want to make the case here, because this happened in 2000, 2001, and 2002. The technology portion of the S&P 500 reached about 37%. So if you looked at the S&P 500, looked at the total valuation of the stocks within the S&P 500, the technology component of that was 37%. Very, very large, mm-hmm. Right? What did well in 2000, 2001, and 2002 were financials and deep value stocks. In fact, those stocks made money in 2000 and 2001. They might have lost a little bit in 2002, but by and large, those sectors did extremely well, even though we were in the midst of the dot-com bubble. Now, what does that mean? That means that most of the time, you can look for opportunities of sectors of the market that are less overvalued or potentially even undervalued as compared to the market as a whole.
Right. So factor investing or active management might come into play in a scenario like that where you're looking to not own the entire market, but be selective with where you're investing.
Right. And you don't just go in and say, well, I'm going to get completely out of this sector and I'm going to go over here. But it tells you where you should potentially be overweight and where you could be potentially be underweighted. And that really is the key. It's dynamic. It's not a set it and forget it type of a scenario. Now, the old saying is a rising tide lifts all boats. That's true, right? And then there's another one of my favorite sayings that Warren Buffett has. He says, it's not till the tide goes out that you see who's swimming naked, right? And so if you have too much exposure to the sectors that may have been the hottest or the most overvalued, you can get smacked pretty hard when those things lose money.
That goes into your strategy of how are you getting money out of the investment account into your checking account to be spent. You, being selective, not just maybe selling investments pro rata across the board, but rebalancing the account strategically to sell the things that maybe have made money in periods where there's investments in your account that have lost money. Maybe you're not touching those.
Yeah, and especially if it's a sector that you have a lot of conviction in, that you know that we're in a temporary lull, you can hold on to those things. But you have to have the plan set up. And towards the end of each year, people should really be sitting down and saying, okay, this is how much we need to spend next year based on our plan. Where's that money going to come from? Should we raise some capital from some winnings this year? I mean, you look at just what's happening here in 2021 and you know, we've had to do rebalancing multiple times this year because the equity markets have gotten out of whack with what are, if you had a 60-40 portfolio and the equity markets are up 20% and bonds are flat, well, you're going to have to rebalance if you want to maintain that 60-40 discipline.
Yeah. And we've written extensively about rebalancing portfolios and we'll link to some of those pieces that we've written in the description.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think if we could take one thing away from this, it's that we can't go back and just look at history. Because if I looked at this history and I said that this is my last 20 years and that's what's my reality, that's not really reality. And we have to look back and say, when were valuations high? What did you do? When was inflation high? What did you do? And we have to stress test people's plans through all those scenarios to come up with what is the proper allocation today? And that might be different, you know, 6 months from now, a year from now. But what is it today that gives us the highest probability of success with the least amount of risk possible?
Right. And if someone had come up to you or I and said, you know, I'm thinking about retirement, but I'm just not sure that it's a good time to retire right now with what's going on in the stock market, you know, what kind of response might you give to that individual?
Well, I think that it's a legitimate concern. But I also think that people need to think about life and not just the stock market. There's nothing out there that can't be navigated through with proper planning and proper attention to it. And it may not be smooth sailing, but we can set up strategies, Jason, like I said, that will allow us to say, let's carve out our first 3 years of income. And let's take that first 3 years of income and let's set it aside in something that's safe. So we know that in the next 3 years, if the markets take a decline, we don't have to sell anything. If we happen to get another good year, another good 6 months, we can take those winnings and dump it back over into that safe bucket so that we've always got the confidence that we've got the money to spend, right?
Yep.
And we're not hampering the ability to still keep a longer-term perspective from our investment strategy. The other thing that I would say is that proper financial planning techniques can take a lot of pressure off the portfolio. Things like proactive forward-looking tax planning, things like Social Security maximization strategies, things like dynamic loss or dynamic gain harvesting. And so there's different ways during different periods that people need to be thinking about things, but it all ties back into what you do in our centralized financial planning department, which is creating that robust financial plan that's not just looking at the investment. In fact, you don't even look at the investments until after your financial plan is completed.
That's right. What I love about that answer to this hypothetical question, right, was not, I understand you're concerned about markets, but go with this portfolio and you're not going to have to worry about anything, because it leads with planning, right? It's all about the planning.
Yeah. And I think the worst thing that a person could do in the environment that we're in today is to go buy one of those target date funds or buy just a simple balanced fund. Because if that fund is a balanced fund and it has a discipline that says that we're going to maintain a 60-40 mix, that means they're going to maintain a 60-40 mix. They're not going to raise cash. You're going to be forced to sell into down markets. And it is one of those things where that can become a self-fulfilling prophecy of you running out of money. You need to have a far more control than just a balanced fund or a target date fund.
Yeah, yeah. Retirement planning, financial planning is so much more than just what's in your portfolio. It takes into consideration all of those other things, Social Security, tax strategies, pension election options, all of these things come into play that are far more important.
They do. Well, I hope that this has been beneficial, and it should just be an eye-opener. And what I would say is that anybody out there that's thinking about retiring in the next 5 to 10 years, or even if you're already retired, they need to get a conversation started with one of our certified financial planners. They can walk them through our whole process, engage you in our centralized financial planning department, and really put together a plan that can provide the clarity that somebody needs to give them confidence.
Yeah, yeah. It starts and ends with the plan in mind.
So there's a good saying out there, clarity equals confidence, confusion equals chaos. So if you're confused about what you should be doing, we can help you get the clarity. That's the key.
Absolutely.
And it changes, right? Over
it
time.
It's dynamic, yeah.
Jason, thanks for being here. Appreciate your time.
Thanks a lot, Dean. This was a fun case study to look at.
Absolutely. Thanks for sticking around. I hope you enjoyed the conversation with Jason Newcomer, CFP, Director of Financial Planning here at Barber Financial Group. I want to encourage you, if you're not a client of Barber Financial Group at all right now, I want you to get a complimentary consultation with one of our certified financial planners so we can get you set on the right track. If you're joining us on YouTube, make sure to click the subscribe button and the bell icon. That way you'll be notified every single time we put a new video out.